There are few animals on the planet that inspire both awe and passion. The giants of the oceans, despite their size, have been at the mercy of human commerce. The few people that fight for the survival of these giants are remarkable, overwhelmed by a profound emotional bond to the mighty whale. These champions of the natural world are usually found in faraway places. Working in the Bahamas and the Cook Islands in the South Pacific, a woman has devoted her life to whales. And from these island paradises, she's determined to secure the whale's future. Nan Hauser is not your typical conservationist. She settled on Rarotonga in 1998, having fallen head over heels for an animal species that needs all the help it can get.
It is a passion. It's not work. Even though I am busy from morning to night and I never take a day off, because you live it.
She's got some, I got a tail fluke on her right side. That's the first time we got that on her.
My whole life has become whales, and I'm criticized sometimes for that from some of my relatives. But I think that we all have a calling. And some people follow it and listen, and some people don't. I hope that most people find that calling.
Nan's call is the haunting sound of whale song.
I don't even think about having to do this or it becoming work. It becomes your life. It just is. So nothing's a chore. Even when you have to write up the scientific papers and raise the money, it's not a chore. And I can't think of anything better than being in a boat, out on the water, with these wild animals, allowing you to just take a little peek into their life, and then to have a good quality camera in my hand to record it.
Taking a peek into their lives is what Nan does best. Both the Bahamas and the Cook Islands boast visits from a number of whale species. By far the most playful are dolphins. In the Bahamas, it's bottlenose and spotted that are most common, and in the Cook Islands, it's spinner dolphins. Probably the most famous whales of all are regular visitors to the islands, the humpbacks. Nan is making a 10-year study of these magnificent animals. Deep divers also pass by. The large-headed sperm whale has been recorded at depths of over 3,000 feet, with standing pressures that can crush a human body like a paper cup. Sharing that extraordinary diving ability is one of the rarest whale species of all, the beaked whale. Nan's footage of these elusive creatures is unique. Because of this deep diving ability and their relatively small size, few people have even heard of beaked whales, despite the fact that they make up a quarter of the 81 species of whales and dolphins. And it's the beaked whales that Nan is determined to fully study and record. Physically, these animals are extraordinary. They're medium-sized with a distinct beak extending from the skull. The type that Nan most often encounters are Blainville's beaked whales. They're also called dense-beaked whales, since their lower jaw is the densest bone in the animal kingdom, denser than elephant ivory. If you're going to stand a chance of finding a beaked whale, then the waters off the Cook Islands are a good place to start. Rarotonga became the base of operations for the island's whale research project. It was set up by Nan with Mike Tavioni, a local woodcarver. Nan is a qualified and experienced nurse and still practices medicine when necessary. She also holds the post of Director of the Center for Cetacean Research and Conservation. When she first arrived at Rarotonga from the shores of New England, Nan was well aware of the violent history between humans and whales. But she was quite unaware of an eerie family history.
Well, there were a handful of women in the world called the petticoat whalers. No one knows a lot about them except from their journals and their diaries. And very few women went off to the whaling ships.
Nan found a gravestone deep in one of the island's forests, a place where outsiders were buried. Here lay 24-year-old Mary Ann Sherman. In 1845, she set out from New England for a South Pacific whaling vessel crewed by men eager to slaughter whales for a living. Nan was staggered to learn that Mary Ann was one of her very own ancestors.
If you look at petticoat whalers, a lot of them were related to me from the old days. And it was a god-awful life on a whaling ship. Especially for a woman, there wasn't water. They were often mutinies, and the captains would hang the crew from their thumbs, and there wasn't room for anybody or anything to move. They just killed whales, and it sounds like the most awful life you could ever live. I sometimes put myself in her position, and it's just kind of amazing that I should end up here in Rarotonga, protecting the whales.
Nan believes she is atoning for the sins of some of her whaling ancestors.
When I came here 7 years ago, I felt like I'd come home.
But Nan's real home is on the ocean. The lure of the Pacific has brought Nan closer to understanding the beaked whale. This rare species came to Nan's attention in a grisly fashion. In March 2000 in the Bahamas, many beaked whales died stranded on beaches. Nan was there to document the tragedy and became determined to find out how such a thing could happen.
The military was doing acoustic exercises in the areas that the animals were stranding. And it's pretty hard to go to the Navy and say, hey, guess what? You're killing these rare, endangered beaked whales that no one knows anything about, and get a response that will say, okay, we'll stop. I mean, they can't say that. We flew down immediately and necropsied the animals and actually cut their heads off and removed them and looked at the ears and did major analysis just to prove that it was the sonar that had been killing these animals. And it was proven, and the Navy accepts responsibility. And actually, from the beginning, my feeling has been to get the Navy and the whale researchers and the acousticians, who really know what they're talking about, to work together. Because I could scream and shout and jump up and down and curse people for killing these animals, but what good is that going to do? If anything, it's going to alienate each of us from each other, and we're not going to solve anything.
Sonar, or sound navigation and ranging, is a way to use sound waves to locate large objects underwater. Harmless to marine life is passive sonar. This is simply listening to sounds picked up by underwater microphones called hydrophones. So, what's doing the damage? Military sonar also sends out low-frequency pings. These send back echoes revealing quieter objects that passive listening cannot detect. There's proof that low-frequency active sonar can cause whale strandings, but it wasn't the culprit in this case. The deaths of the Bahamas beaked whales were due to the Navy's tactical mid-range frequency sonar. It's thought that the pulses produced intense pain to the ears. In panic, the whales may have gone into a rapid ascent that caused fatal nitrogen narcosis. The bends.
So then if we learn more about it, then perhaps we can somehow work with the Navy to find a way to stop killing these animals.
However, learning more about beaked whales means finding one alive. Every spring, Nan and her research team head to the Abuko Keys for 5 weeks of research on beaked whales and other cetaceans. Life in the Bahamas is lived at a leisurely pace with all the sun, sand, and surf that anyone could wish for. It's a happy coincidence that beaked whales are more likely to be found here, one of the world's most idyllic destinations. And perched on the leafy shore is a building known as the Owl's Nest.
Well, this is where it all began, here at the Owl's Nest, at the head of the eastern harbor of Maniwar Key. And I came here in 1995 as a production researcher for a dolphin film. I didn't really know where I was coming to live until I got here, so you can imagine how excited I was about moving into this wonderful place.
The Owl's Nest has a nautical feel to it, and for good reason.
This house has great character. It was built by Todd Lee, a man whose passion is to build boats and to be here at the end of the harbor. It was a place where a lot of work was done. A lot of discoveries that I made were made while I was living here. And I brought my children with me, and they too have had many years of some homeschooling and exploring and learning about whales and dolphins.
Nan was brought up to regard the world as her classroom. She felt that her children would get a more exhilarating education on the ocean than in a traditional school. As official research assistants, they drove the boat, spotted whales, identified tail flukes, taped behavior, and enjoyed a remarkable childhood. Dolphin research brought Nan and her children to the Bahamas. These playful creatures enabled Nan to discover their much more elusive relatives, the beaked whales. Derek and Margot Lee kindly donate their dockhouse next door to the Owl's Nest to Nan and her team every year. The first step on any conservation pathway is to find volunteers. Ironically, saving the planet, the most important job of all, is mostly unpaid labor. On the agenda today, beaked whales.
Oh, but check out the one with the dorsal fin. It's flopped over.
Oh, yeah.
That was the same encounter. It wasn't the same animal. And some people say when it's flopped over like that, that the animal's depressed. So it's a good thing we have a psychiatrist on the team.
I say a little Viagra would probably work well.
I can be cocaine, too.
I was supposed to say Prozac, not Viagra. Okay, let's look at some of the footage.
Okay. All right.
After years of patient searching, Nan has managed to shoot reference material on the rare beaked whale. From this footage, it's clear that the whales don't live in perfect peace with each other. Those marks on the male's back are scars.
One of the big questions is, how do these males get all the scars on their backs? We assume that it's a competitive behavior, sort of maybe a dominance thing. By measuring the distance between the scars, that they might approach each other like this, flip over, and ram each other.
It's a viable theory. There are other animals that exhibit this behavior.
And scratch each other deeply with the teeth that are above their head on this jawbone that comes up here. Nobody's ever seen it, so my challenge is to film it. I really want to get it on film.
First challenges first. Nan and her team are here to rehearse fitting a beaked whale with an acoustic tag. Mark McDonald is an expert in whale acoustics.
Mark, I'm really glad you're here. This has been like a 5-year dream of mine to have somebody come with an acoustic tag, so thanks for coming down.
Well, you're the inspiration here ever since the Marine Mammal Conference where, you know, saw the beaked whales here, so. And the whole Navy sonar issue is what's, you know, really switched me away from baleen whales to these beaked whales. So here we are with tag number 7.
It's hard for me to imagine that this is worth $14,000.
Actually, if we'd had more funding, we probably could have had some new ones built for this project. But for right now,
maybe next year.
That's right, next year.
With such delicate and expensive equipment, a dry run, so to speak, is all important. As well as practicing the tagging, the team will be putting a hydrophone through its paces. Similar to the Navy's underwater microphones, this device can record the sounds that whales make. Team head out into the open sea for a dress rehearsal. This research is vital if beaked whales are going to stay safe from our technology. The sounds the team are hoping to record are out of our hearing range. Imagine a species being on the planet for at least 25 million years and yet we know next to nothing about them. The hydrophone can record up to frequencies of 250 kilohertz, well beyond the range of human hearing. We can hear just up to 20 kilohertz. Once the recording is made, a computer can lower the frequency to enable the scientists to actually hear the whale sounds.
Obviously the sound's working.
To practice his tagging technique, Mark needs to thrust the suction caps with enough force so that the tag attaches securely.
Third one over here.
Once attached to the whale, the tag is able to transmit data. If successful, Nan and her team will find out exactly how deep these creatures are able to dive, how long they can hold their breath, and how they communicate. With $14,000 on the end of the pole, any mistakes, and someone's going to get wet.
Oh, there goes the tag.
Yep.
Is that the real tag?
Yeah, it's the real tag.
There's the whale right now.
Casey's an expert retriever.
But with the unpredictability of the weather and the need for flat water to even catch a glimpse of a beaked whale, scientists have learned to be patient. With fingers crossed, the attempt to attach a tag will be successful next year. Or will the beaked whales keep their secrets? While these rare creatures command Nan's attention in the spring each year, it is her ongoing 10-year study of humpback whales on which most of her energies are focused. And far from the sunny climes of the Bahamas in the frigid waters of Alaska's Chatham Straits, the Northern Hemisphere humpback whales begin their annual migration to the warmer waters of Hawaii. Famous for its long, complex, and haunting songs, the humpback whale is perhaps the most interesting and best studied of the baleen whales. Frequently spotted in shallow waters near coastlines, humpbacks migrate seasonally from polar feeding grounds in summer to tropical and subtropical breeding locations in winter. Humpbacks are solitary animals, often traveling alone and coming together in social pods during feeding and mating. For reasons at which we can only guess, they also breach, throwing their massive bulk skyward and crashing down in an eruption of water. Nan assisted Dr. Fred Sharp in Alaska as he studied the phenomenal cooperative feeding behavior called bubble netting. A cylindrical underwater enclosure is created with bubbles as walls, from which large shoals of fish cannot escape. Then all the whales rise from underneath the concentrated shoals with mouths wide open, breaking the surface and pushing water out with their tongue. Humpbacks are baleen whales, named after the rugged horn-like material that grows from their upper jaw. These baleen plates hang down in parallel rows and are used to filter food from the water in their mouths. In composition, they resemble human fingernails and have bristles on the outer edge to trap food. In the southern hemisphere, humpbacks are on an opposite schedule. As the northern hemisphere whales arrive in Alaska for feeding, those in the lower latitudes appear off the shores of the Cook Islands for mating and giving birth. Returning home from the Bahamas is always a thrill. The endless ocean, and then slowly, the tropical paradise is revealed. 15 islands, or atolls, of volcanic coral thrust out of the sea. Including the surrounding ocean, this is an area of over 1 million square miles. That's roughly the size of India. The island's history is surprisingly diverse. They were named after Captain James Cook, the famous British navigator and explorer. The New Zealand Maoris originated from the islands, having set out for their new home over 600 years ago. This was Captain William Bligh's last stop before his ship, the Bounty, was taken over by mutineers. The beauty of the location belies the island's more savage past. Warriors lived here, and the remains of their conquests can still be found in the many caves. Nan finds much to appreciate about her adopted island home.
Everything's special about the Cook Islands, the people, the culture, the land, but especially the whales. We see a number of different whales, different species, but what I primarily focus on are the humpbacks. They come from July, August, September, October, and they're migrating from Antarctica, where they've been feeding for 4 to 6 months. They migrate about 4,000 miles, go past the Cook Islands. They don't necessarily stay there, but they go past, and they come to mate and give birth.
The more Nan discovered about these creatures, the more she was driven to protect them. This meant wading into the murkier waters of politics.
I have a very strong philosophy of why learn it if you don't share it? And I can go around to schools and teach, and I love doing that. But I felt that if I raised the money and built a center in the Cook Islands, that not only tourists and locals and school children would come, but in that way, everybody could be part of it and everyone could learn from it.
Of all the people in the world, I think we have to salute Nan Hauser.
I was really fortunate to meet an incredible inspiration and mentor in my life, a woman named Erica Terpstra, who was senior member of parliament in Holland at the time.
I tried to realize them.
Erica is well known in her native country. She won Olympic gold and bronze medals for swimming, and since 1977 has held many government positions. Currently, she's the president of the Netherlands Olympic Committee and continues to inspire others.
Listen, if you got a dream, if you get involved in improving the quality of life in the world, if you got that dream, then you've got to inspire a lot of people to get a tiny little bit of that dream realized.
On a trip to the Cook Islands in 2001, she met Nan and became a powerful ally.
Well, first, when I met her, I went to the Paradise Inn and I found her and I introduced myself, and she goes, "You are Nan Hauser? You could not be Nan Hauser. You could not be." I picture Nan Hauser as a very old, wise woman. I love her. I love her. And then the next day, in the parking lot of the Paradise Inn, she said, "I must tell you this. I must tell you. I know that in a past life we knew each other and we were very good friends." And I said, "I agree. I feel total sisterhood." She said, "Yes. Perhaps I was a whale and you were a dolphin." I just love her.
Lobbying politicians on environmental issues has long since been an uphill struggle. Would the leaders of the Cook Islands come to see their whales as something that needed political protection? Over the years, Nan met with many members of the Cook Islands Parliament, stating her case again and again.
Mike Donohue and Claire Garry.
Yes,
we definitely should.
They had a representative over there doing their lobbying there.
We'd like to think about doing is.
Yeah, but last month there was another attempt to put it through the International Whaling Commission, and it didn't succeed.
But I know we'll get it eventually. It's just going to take some focus.
Nan's persistence paid off. It was mostly the hard work of Dr. Robert Wunton, soon to be Prime Minister of the Cook Islands, which won the day and pushed the legislation through.
I think all of us are here with one conviction, to be able to assist one of the wonders of the world, the leviathans of the deep, our whales. A small sesame seed is sown today in the Cook Islands that will one day grow into something that the rest of the world will appreciate.
What Nan was proposing was a whale sanctuary within the EEZ of the Cook Islands. Something on this scale had never been achieved before. Nan was asking the government to secure an area over 1 million square miles. And incredibly, she made it happen. The whole of Western Europe could comfortably fit within its boundary. The sanctuary was created in 2001 and was the largest of its kind at the time. To the whales, the sanctuary means legal protection. To the islanders, it's given them a feeling of ownership and pride in their whales. As their awareness increases, that pride becomes stronger. To maintain the awareness of their precious visitors, Nan began building a whale center in 2001. With a lot of help from their friends, Nan and Mike Tavioni opened the centre in 2002. And it's a popular tourist attraction as well as a learning portal for the island's children.
It was great because I had so much whale stuff. I hardly had to go out and buy anything, but I had skeletons and photos and teeth and specimens, and so everything's on display, and it's become very, very popular.
She's working on a beautiful orca over there.
By educating, we're raising awareness, and that's what we need to do. I wish that we could have more important things as headlines in the papers to raise the awareness of people instead of all the bad news that we get every day.
Oh, very nice.
Okay, does anybody know what this is?
Whale oil.
Whale oil, that's right. It's perfect oil. Want to smell it? It smells good now, but when a whale dies, it doesn't smell very good. People come to the center, and they have a better understanding of the whales that they've always had as a nation. And the government's been so wonderful and so supportive.
One of Nan's primary goals in her teaching is to make the inhabitants of the islands realize how precious their environment is, how special the whales are.
That's too big. All right, on your mark. Get set, go. Ah!
If you teach the children the natural value of what they may take for granted living here, then the future of the whales is a little more assured.
Okay, what's this?
Finlip.
On the whale.
Finlip.
No, it looks like that. Okay, what happens? What's this called?
Slip it.
A peck slap. Okay, and what's it called when the whale comes out? How'd you know I was going to say that?
The children of Rarotonga may be fortunate enough to see sights like this throughout their winter. Here, a humpback calf is having a ball, while his mother and her consort are enjoying some quality time together. What will make the difference is if the children are prepared to ensure that their oceans stay as inviting to the whales as the whales are to Nan. The children do have one thing in common with their giant visitors. They both sing. Of all the attributes of the humpback whale, it's their song that captivates us most. This haunting, ethereal sound has come to symbolize for some the eternal mystery of nature.
The song is very loud, it's very beautiful. It's about 16 to 20 minutes long, and it's made up of phrases which are repeated over and over again. Only the males sing, and they all sing a different song in each area. The humpback whales in Australia, the ones on the East Coast, had actually picked up a phrase from the humpbacks on the West Coast. And this happened too a few years ago in the Cook Islands. We had a whale come in, and it sang a totally new song, but it was made up of three phrases, and we didn't recognize any of them. And they were really odd. And the first phrase I call the creaky door, and it went. And the second phrase I called broken chainsaw, which I'm not sure if I could even do it. It sounded like you're trying to start a broken chainsaw. And the third phrase was the worst. It is what I call the laughing monkey phrase. And it went. And it wouldn't stop. And wouldn't you know it, that 6 days later, one of the whales in the Cook Islands had incorporated the monkey phrase into the song. So we just had to get used to it.
However, as seemingly friendly and majestic as the humpbacks are, It's always wise to remember that these are wild animals and about 600 times heavier than you are. One swish of a fin or a tail, and you will count yourself lucky if you emerge from the ocean with mere broken bones. The impact would crush your internal organs. Nan records all of her research trips. In one incident, she was filming when a humpback intentionally rammed her boat.
Out of nowhere, a female and an escort and a calf came towards my boat in Rarotonga. This is normal, but she kept coming and coming and coming until she rammed the side of the boat and lifted it up out of the water and twisted, and we slid down the whale's back. And she twisted a little bit more, and I was shocked because, first of all, it's not really the kind of behavior we see with humpback whales. Perhaps a sperm whale is better known for ramming boats. And yet, once she calmed down and I got in the water, she was very friendly. In fact, friendly enough that she left her calf with me and went off for 8 minutes the first time with the male. I could see her about a kilometer away, splish-splashing away with him, the male escort. It was as if she was almost relieved that she had a babysitter. And when she came back, she was very friendly. She came up to me. I was just probably 3 feet away from her. And she stared at me and swam past. And I spent 33 days with her.
Of all the whales that Nan has documented, this was the longest period a single individual had stayed at Rarotonga. Her calf was sick and needed time to recover before moving on.
She got very friendly. She'd come to the boat every day when she'd see me. She'd come streaming towards the boat, stopping right next to the edge and bringing her head up as if to say hi. It was quite lovely, actually. I named her my mama. And what a great animal she was. Even though she was the only one that ever rammed my boat, she was still a great character.
Recording such huge animals at such close range is a risky business. But to Nan, the results are well worth it.
Watch the calf. We're going to go back a little bit. Okay, watch the calf's mouth and listen to the sound.
If a rarely seen behavior is captured, like this petulant jaw pop from my mama's calf having a temper tantrum, Nan can share it and inspire younger generations to want to learn more. Beneath the surface of the water is a truly alien world, right on Nan's doorstep. But away from the water, Nan's need for a quiet spot to wind down, write up and catalogue her many research papers becomes paramount. Considerably grander than the owl's nest in the Bahamas is Nan's home here in Rarotonga, where she does most of her dry land work. Making time for domestic chores and a spot of gardening is not up to Nan. It's up to the whales. And when they call...
Whale research. Just wondering what you have up around the point.
Well, yeah, we're up by Manavera Point. There's a couple of whales up there looking a bit aggressive into each other. One's sort of rushing in and being a bit territorial, I think, over.
Okay, roger that. Some competitive behavior going on. Must be some looking for some females. Okay, Wayne, well, we'll head up that way in a little while after we get some IDs and some skin. Thanks for that report. Let's keep in touch.
I can end. We'll see you soon. We're back to 16.
As well as collecting data on identification, behavior, and acoustics, Nan tries to find pieces of whale skin for analysis of their DNA. This provides evidence of species, the sex of the animal, and its relationship to other whales.
Where the whale dives down and flukes its tail up, it's called a footprint. It's a very calm, round area. And if I scoop down in there, I can usually find a piece of skin. Okay, we got breaching!
The real skin sample bonanza occurs when a whale breaches as the impact on the water shaves off dead skin like a giant razor.
Jeez! Sorry, I need to get where you guys are. Woo! Look at this! Looks like a waste paper basket. Oh my gosh! Look at this skin! Unbelievable.
For DNA typing, only small pieces are needed. Nan has hit the mother load.
I think we have enough skin in there. Look at all that DNA. Can't believe it. That's the beauty when they breach. If they tail slap, or they breach, or they do a peck slap, you're guaranteed skin. That's great. And I just gotta make sure you get all that DNA out of the strainer so you don't get it mixed up with the next whale. That looks pretty good. Yahoo! Well done.
Almost as precise as DNA in identifying the animals are the humpback's tail flukes. Each is as individual as a human fingerprint.
Can we see your tail fluke, please? Please?
Hours and hours of staring at the blue are rewarded in mere seconds.
Come on, baby. Fluke, 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 fluke. Yes! Thank you. That was perfect, even the lighting.
Sometimes the whales aren't as cooperative. There's only one option then. Do as the Romans do. For research purposes, Nan has government permission to dive with whales, something expressly forbidden in all other cases. This 360 maneuver isn't just joie de vivre on Nan's part. Before diving, it's always a good idea to take a good look around. Here there might be whales, but here also there may be sharks. And as a torrent of bubbles from an aqualung is often interpreted as a sign of aggression by whales, scaring them off, holding your breath and free diving is the only option. But in the company of whales, any concerns are swiftly forgotten. With a good crop of specimens fished from the ocean and flukes photographed, Nan exchanges the sea for the road. But, true to character, she stays on the boat. Sharing space with the frozen peas and the milk are the recently acquired specimens of skin. Nan carefully catalogues them by storing them in a 96% alcohol solution. She details the species, time and date of acquisition, and prepares the samples to be sent to the laboratory at the University of Auckland. To understand the morphology of a rare animal, you have to go back to what's available. And in the case of the beaked whale, that means the bones. This is the skull of Mesoplodon densirostris. But far from providing answers, washed-up bones sometimes reveal a hitherto unknown species. There is still so much to learn and to do that Nan has to put in the time. Hours and hours of simply watching the ocean.
Finding beaked whales is really hard. It takes a lot of patience, a lot of time on the water, and standing up in the boat, looking and doing nothing else but looking for a little glimmer at the surface of the water.
But when serendipity is on her side, anything is possible.
Come on, baby. Whoa! Did you see that? That's a little calf. That's a newborn. Holy! What's it doing by itself? It's a newborn.
There's two of them.
Oh my God, she's got a newborn. Oh my God. Oh, did you see that newborn baby?
Nan can tell that this is a newborn by observing the way the animal breathes. It bobs up high in the water next to its mother instead of merely grazing the surface.
I can't. Where did this calf come from? This calf may have just been born.
Okay, looks like they're coming up.
Nan has had a number of encounters with these rare animals, including several species of beaked whale. She's even managed to shoot underwater reference material on them. This is an older calf, still suckling despite being 70% of the size of its mother.
It was really interesting, though, because if you were aggressive and you felt like, oh, I've got to get this shot, and I'm going to get this shot, and oh, if they would just hold still, and it doesn't work. You just have to sort of be there and have no expectations and sort of hold the camera here against your chest and look at them eye to eye. And they're trying to figure out what you are because they've never seen a human. And you're trying to figure out what they are because we don't know anything about them.
But slowly we're learning, thanks to the efforts of people like Nan Hauser, people absolutely committed to whale conservation.
The work is never done. No, the work's never done. I'll spend the rest of my life looking at these mysterious whales. And even though a lot of people told me that I couldn't do it, I mean, I used to get seasick sitting on the dock. I'm shocked that I can do it too. But I did it. And every time I'm in the water, I'm in awe. I'm in awe.
More.